Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. I just wanted to give you a little bit of a summary of what you're going to see. This is a video. It's an excerpt of a longer video. It's the panel members discussing the bio threat, and it's actually moderated by Max Brooks. I think it's sort of a cool video myself. And just to let you know, the entire video is on our website. So if you'd like to see that, I encourage you to do that. It's going to last about, I think it's 12 or 13 minutes. And then we'll go ahead and start with the program. So thank you.
Governor Ridge, for those of us who don't know anything about biodefense, who've never even heard the term, just briefly, what are we talking about?
I think in order to explain biodefense, it's probably best if we think in terms of a traditional defense terms, because people pay attention to defense. They worry about who's the enemy, what's the nature of the threat, what harm can it cause, and how hopefully can we prevent it. But if something happens, are we able to respond and recover? Well, when we talk about biodefense, we're not talking about munitions, we're not talking about soldiers, we're not talking about guns and bombs, we're talking about germs. And so the whole notion of biodefense is how does this country, as it looks at biodefense, let's look at it the same way you look at national defense. What's the threat? Germs. It's a global threat. Zika, Ebola reminds us of that. Is there a way we can detect them, just like we'd like to detect the offensive capability of nation states, as we think in terms of traditional national defense? What are our measures to counter those threats? Well, do we have medical countermeasures to respond to those germs, to that potential pandemic that may come to us from a nation state, may come to us from a terrorist, maybe an accidental discharge from a laboratory, and worst of all, maybe Mother Nature's going to throw it at us. And then if we are able to detect it, but all of a sudden it hits us, how do we respond and recover it? So when I think in terms of biodefense, I go all the way from detection and trying to prevent it from happening to providing those countermeasures to deal with it to responding and recovery. It's like anything else. It is a real risk. It's a global risk. But it's a risk, I think, that Americans need to, one, accept as a reality. It is a permanent reality, but it's a risk that with the right kind of biodefense strategy, prioritizing resources, we can manage that risk. So that's my view of what biodefense is all about.
Okay, so breaking down that risk, Senator Lieberman, taking a step back from the military defense angle of this, what about just viruses in nature? How easily can one of them accidentally find their way into the United States?
Yeah, all too easily. We've worked together on this bipartisan panel to try to raise awareness of the bio threat, both infectious disease and from terrorists. And I come to the conclusion that the threat is greater than it's ever been, and our ability to deal with it is not what it should be, though we have the ability to make it better, and hopefully we will. But one of the challenges here is that this is pretty hard to stop. I mean, the Department of Homeland Security put out what they call material threat determinations for infectious disease outbreaks. What's most likely to occur. And every one of them, except one, smallpox, is caused by animals. Let's take Zika, which alarmed so many people so recently and still does. It's still here, and the odds are it's going to spread more. You can't put up a wall high enough to stop the mosquitoes from coming in that brought Zika, or you can't stop people from coming in on planes from a certain place because the mosquitoes will still come in. The great carriers of infectious disease are birds. And that's really also, obviously, you can put up a high wall, but the birds can fly over it. So the probabilities are great that we're going to have an infectious disease epidemic or a pandemic, which is a very big epidemic. Now, just let me go back to history to show that this is more than us being alarmists or science fiction or whatever. Almost 100 years ago, in 1918, there was an outbreak of flu, Spanish influenza, that killed at least 50 million people in 1 year. Some people say it killed as many as 100 million, but they don't have the numbers. And right now, for instance, in a part of China, there's a flu epidemic, a cause we can see by people who had direct contact with poultry in poultry markets. It hasn't affected that many people yet, but 40% of the people affected are dying. Let me make it personal for a minute, Max. My father's mother was killed in the flu, died as a result of the flu epidemic of 1918. He was 2 and a half, he never really knew her. His father felt he couldn't take care of him, put him in an orphanage until he was 10 when my grandfather remarried and he brought him out. That had a tremendous effect on my dad's life and on all of us as children. And yet, I think about it sometimes, it was relatively manageable for him, except of course he lost his mother. But the way in which the flu epidemic dislocated millions of people around the world, it could happen again. We're traveling much more than people did in 1918, but we also have the capacity to develop countermeasures much better than they did at that time, and shame on us if we don't.
And this is nature. This has nothing to do with governments, terrorists. This is literally just what comes out of a poultry farm or a jungle.
Exactly, or a bird flying, or a mosquito biting somebody.
Right. I think it's important that we don't even try to discriminate whether it's a terrorist instigated event or it's naturally occurring, or God forbid, there are some countries that have signed up to an international protocol, the Biological Weapons Convention, and we don't have enough intelligence to suggest that everybody's abiding by it. Mm. It's immaterial. A germ's a germ, regardless of the source, and all of us have spent the past 2 years trying to elevate awareness around the notion that the threat's real. We could do so much more with a few more targeted resources. But it's almost, it's not helpful, I think, and we've decided as a panel, it's not helpful to say, well, it might be accidentally discharged from a lab, or the terrorists threw it at you, or Mother Nature threw it at you. Germ's a germ, doesn't know anything about politics, doesn't know anything about geography, you get infected. It's something the country's got to worry about.
And it's all a national security risk.
Exactly.
Okay.
Whether it's caused by another country, a terrorist, or a terrorist group, it still threatens our national security. It makes a nation not very stable when they have this kind of an outbreak because of the resources they have to devote and because of the fear that this kind of an epidemic will foster.
Now, you bring up a good point about that germs, as much as bombs, are a threat to national security. So naturally, people out there who want to threaten the United States will want to use them. Representative Greenwood, if someone were to use a germ instead of a bullet or a bomb, how would they go about doing it today as opposed to back in the Middle Ages where they used to catapult plague-infected bodies over the walls of castles, or back in our own country's history when smallpox-infested blankets were given to Native Americans? What would the modern bioterrorist have at his disposal?
So if we're talking high-tech weaponizing of a virus or a bacterium, it's pretty hard because you have to change the genetics. Mm-hmm. And for that, you need someone who is a PhD in microbiology, has enough information to figure out how to do that to make a virus or a bacterium, say, more infectious or more lethal or maybe able to survive outside of a body and be contagious. So that's pretty tough, but the problem is it's getting easier because the equipment to do that you can buy basically on eBay now. And the internet is so full of information, a lot of it put there by some very bad people, about how to do this kinds of thing, that it's getting easier. We have a field called synthetic biology now, where you can basically make up your own species practically. I mean, you just take the genes and you combine them in new and different ways, and that can be particularly threatening. Now, there's also low-tech weaponizing of these bacterium and viruses. And the way you do that is not much different than what you just described, but you can take a martyr, someone who's willing to give up their life, and there are no shortage of them, unfortunately, get them sick with smallpox or SARS or some other highly infectious disease, put a bunch of them on airplanes, and have them fly to our country, get out of the airports, touch things, railings, take another flight. And that would be, it wouldn't kill necessarily millions of people, but it would be real terror, because it would be popping up here and popping up there, and people would not know they had these diseases immediately, and then they would start falling. And that would be horrifying.
So you bring up an important point about the distinction between a bioattack and a nuclear attack. Because a nuclear attack requires fissile material, uranium, which is very hard to find, very hard to manufacture. You still need a nation state to turn uranium into weapons-grade plutonium. But what you're saying is eBay, with a germ attack, you can actually order a bio kit on eBay now. And the information you would need is literally on the internet. I remember when I was a kid, we had the Anarchist Cookbook, which taught you how to make a bomb, and it was very scary. Mm-hmm. But that's baby food compared to what is available now.
Right.
And
because it is increasingly possible to do this, and although you need sophisticated scientists, unfortunately, they can be recruited by the bad guys too. So because it is getting easier and easier, we have to get ahead of the game and be more prepared than we ever have before. And the problem with that is what you call recency bias. We just learned that term today from a witness. And that is, if something hasn't happened recently, we kind of forget about it. We put it in the past, even though the threat is persistent.
Right, which harkens back to, in World War II, the British used an aircraft carrier for the first time to sink battleships in a harbor at Taranto. And nobody paid attention to it except the Japanese a year later at Pearl Harbor. So people don't really understand that something can happen until it already has.
Right. And then we're in the locking the barn after the horses are gone syndrome, and we just can't afford to do
that. Now, getting back to germs versus nukes, Senator Daschle, we have spent, certainly since 9/11, a tremendous amount of time, energy, resources, money, and American blood to ensure that a terrorist does not sneak a nuclear weapon into the United States. That's been the doomsday scenario since 9/11. And yet, from everything that we're talking about, it sounds like a bioattack could potentially be more dangerous than a nuclear attack. Is that hyperbole or is that truth?
That's not hyperbole at all. In fact, Congressman Greenwood's recency experience is one I can relate to. My office was the target of an anthrax attack a month after 9/11, and it was an aerosolable anthrax compound in an envelope. A member of my staff opened it up, and 28 people were exposed. 6 people had died in previous experiences in the last month prior to that moment. But it doesn't take much imagination to think about that aerosolable quality in a sports complex, a metro system. Anything that has an enclosure where aerosolability becomes just an enormous capacity for spreading this threat through miles, perhaps, of tunneling, or over 70, 80,000 people in a sports complex. So the threat is real, the technology is there, the capacity is inevitable, and I don't think there's any question that at some point we're going to be facing circumstances like that, making the anthrax attack in my office affecting only 28 people look like a picnic. I mean, it is the consequences of biodefense are every bit as serious, every bit as consequential, as any nuclear scenario I can think of.
I think you bring up two very important points. I think, number one, a nuclear bomb only goes off once, whereas a biological weapon can spread potentially throughout the entire country. And I think you brought up the second point, is that when a nuclear bomb goes off, you know it's gone off, as opposed to infecting people who may not know they have been infected until 24 to 48 hours later. I remember with anthrax, I believe the first person who died didn't know they were infected. And if they're allowed to get out and spread, then within a few weeks, the entire country could have something roaming around and not realize it until the symptoms show up.
Exactly. And more often than not, we have to treat them within 2 days.
Mm.
And if the symptoms take some time, it's almost impossible to save lives.
So I'd say if one of these infectious diseases, let's say, starts in an animal or a bird, goes to people, and then it starts to spread among people. We're accustomed to saying, oh, something can only be transmitted by exchange of bodily fluids. We're talking about airborne pathogens here. Mm-hmm. And that's why it could spread so quickly. That's why the flu epidemic of 1918 killed at least 50 million people. So one of the things we found is that the detection system that was set up after 9/11, after the anthrax attacks on Senator Daschle's office, is not really functioning. It's not up to the technology today. And our government really ought to invest in that, because the other early warning, if you will, is to improve the collection of information in real time from hospitals around America. That if people start to show up with similar symptoms, bells have got to go, information's got to be transmitted to Washington, and bells have got to go off that something is going on out there that we have to begin to fight against. If I may, because I know you're a historian, I just want to make this general point. What we're dealing with here in the threat of biological warfare and biological disease, but particularly biological warfare, is unfortunately as old as human history, which is that just about every great development advances civilization, going back to fire, but then is used for violent, hostile, aggressive purposes. So, you know, somebody else said the 21st century will be the century of biology, meaning that in very positive ways, which advances in biology will improve all our lives and extend all our lives. At the same time, if you've got terrorists and they're out there and they're smart enough, they want to use advances in biology, they can create havoc.